So, Joe, I don't know if you know, there's, somewhere around 7, 8, 9, 10,000 astrophysicists in the world. And about, what are we up to? 7, 8 billion people. If you divide those two numbers, an astrophysicist is 1 in a million in the world.
Whoa.
So if you're ever in the same room with one, that's when you need to ask all the questions because you just never know the next chance that's coming.
I wonder,
do you have any questions that you've been harboring your whole life about the universe that you can ask right now?
Yes,
What's that?
I was thinking just before that, I wonder if it's the same amount as comedians, like professional comedians. I bet it's really similar.
Okay. However, comedians as a practice are always in front of many people.
Yes.
Being a comedian, you are in front of tons of people.
Right.
Being a scientist, we're never in front of anybody.
Right.
So access to comedians, I think, is much higher than to scientists, to astrophysicists.
Oh, no doubt.
I bet those numbers could be the same.
I bet they're pretty close.
Yeah.
So here's my question. The concept of the multiverse,
yeah,
the concept of alternative universes with alternative laws of physics is incredibly puzzling to me.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you think about the idea that this could be reality, that there could be other universes with different laws of physics, there could be an infinite number of these different laws of physics and different – how does that work?
Okay. So that's an excellent question. We think – when I say we – just the scientific community, physicists who concern themselves with the very early universe, cosmologists, that the laws of physics as we experience them are set in the very earliest stages of the universe. And quantum fluctuations in everything would be responsible for another universe having slightly different laws of physics than ours, because the quantum fluctuations will take it in a slightly different law of physics direction than our universe. And this would just keep going. Every universe that's born, even if it started out sort of the same in the very first instant, a later instant when other laws of physics manifest, could be slightly different. And with the multiverse, where there could be pockets of the universe that are expanding with no knowledge of any other pockets of the universe, these are essentially independent universes from one another, and never the twain will meet. Imagine you're a ship at sea and you look to the horizon, and that's your whole universe there to the horizon. There's another ship that has its own horizon, and you declare, this is the universe, and these ships don't even see each other. Okay? You'll only see each other if somehow your two horizons can overlap. And we don't know how to do that in our universe because they're it's called non-causal. All right? You'd have to find some way to tunnel from one universe to the other in order to access that. But that could be very dangerous because if the laws of physics are different than the ones you evolved on, then you could just dissolve into a pile of goo because the charge on the electron is different and all of your biochemistry would change. So the difference in laws of physics comes about because of quantum physics. I don't want to call it random. It's random but predictable. So in other words, you can have a variation in the properties of something and because of the quantum fluctuations that exist within it. And when that's happening in the early universe, you are quantum fluctuating the laws of physics themselves. And that's how you get one universe with a slightly different laws of physics than the other. There could be a universe where the laws of physics there will never allow matter to coalesce. You'll never get stars. That would be a lifeless universe, as far as we can think. There could be another universe where you can make stars, but you don't make heavy elements. That would be a universe with stars, beautiful night skies as we have now, but nothing that we know and love. No planets, no life. Nothing, because our ingredients come from the centers of stars that explode. The manufacturers, the whole periodic table of elements, where does that come from? Exploding stars. Okay? So you can imagine other universes that are not our universe. There could be universes way cooler than ours. Universes where they formed life way faster than ours did. Okay? We didn't have enough ingredients to make life until we can make a planet. Every time a star blows up and it has these heavy elements, it's not enough the first round. You got to accumulate them. And we're like second or third generation supernova here in our solar system. And only then you get enough to have oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, silicon, iron. We got enough. We got a solid planet.
So there's more than one supernova has to take place before enough elements?
More than one generations of supernova, yeah. You can add up how much that is, and it's feeding the entire galaxy.
So meaning a star has to supernova, and then a new star has to form, and then supernova.
Correct, correct. So you need a couple, you need a few of those generations to get enough density of non-original star material to make things like, make a whole balls of planets, for example.
Is it possible?
And even so, it's not very much material. As big as Saturn and Jupiter are, they're made of mostly
gas,
mostly right. hydrogen and helium that were made in the Big Bang, not made in stars.
Is it possible that there's something else that could be invented or created, rather, when more generations of supernovas occur that hasn't happened yet? Like it took so many generations for planets to...
Very interesting. So we are the product of the mixtures of ingredients that are in this universe. So if you rank the elements in your body, the number one element is hydrogen contained in the water molecule, because we're mostly water, as you may remember from biology. The next most common atom is oxygen from the water molecule. Third most is carbon, and we carbon-based life. Fourth most is nitrogen. Well, wait a minute. Those are the top four ingredients in the universe itself. In order. Sorry, not including helium, which is chemically inert. You couldn't use it anyway. So it's the top four chemically active ingredients in the universe. We're made of that. So you ask a brilliant question. Is there some other universe that has a different mixture of other ingredients and they opportunistically made stuff out of those other ingredients? What would they be? Well, that's a great question. I have never thought about that. What would a universe be like if it was mostly molybdenum or something? Pick some elements. Pick some random other four set of elements and see what you can come up with. You know, you need some chemical activity in it. Carbon is highly reactive with other elements, so that's good. It's not an accident that we're carbon-based. We think other life elsewhere in the universe would be carbon-based because carbon is plentiful. And it bonds in so many different ways. If you're experimenting with the diversity of life, carbon is your element to do that on. So this urge to say, let's see if you have silicon-based life. You sure? Because silicon sits right below carbon on the periodic table. It makes all the same kinds of molecules. You heard of carbon dioxide, CO2? There's silicon dioxide, SiO2. It makes the same families of molecules. So you can... Why not make life? Sure, maybe, but there's five times as much carbon in the universe as silicon. You don't have to appeal to silicon. Carbon is there knocking on your door. So for me, what's curious to me is the assertion that if we have a multiverse and there's an infinite number of universes, that means there's an infinite combinations of all things that had ever happened ever, that there's another pair of us having this conversation in another universe, except... you're wearing a red shirt and I'm wearing a whatever. I mean, you make tiny changes in what is and say that's happening in one other universe somewhere. And people are wondering, does this give you immortality? If you exist in this other universe, is that really you? If your entire molecular structure is identical, is that really you? And I think people are overstepping there. I don't think it's really you. It's a copy of you, but it's not you. And my evidence for that is if you're a twin, you don't wake up as your twin ever, even though you are molecularly identical to each other from birth. You don't share each other's conscience. So one of you is an exact replica of the other, except you're not the same human beings. So I can make an exact replica of you somewhere else, but I don't think you'll know or care or feel it. So this talk of I will live forever, even when you upload your consciousness, we don't understand consciousness enough to know what makes you you and me me. Why do I wake up as me every day and not as you or as anybody else? That's consciousness. Can that be carbon copied and or carbon copy? Can that be duplicated and put somewhere else and that still be you? Or are you just making a twin who has a whole other independent consciousness? That's what keeps me up at night. But this concept of different laws of physics is all from the quantum.
I think it's going to keep me up at night too.
Thanks, Joe, for your question.
You. My pleasure.
This has been Star Talk, one-on-one with the one and only Joe Rogan, wrestling, MMAing his deepest questions in the cosmos.